Hello viewers, in today's lecture we will discuss iterative methods to solve this system of linear equations. In previous lectures we discussed the direct methods for solving system of simultaneous equations such as Gauss elimination method, Gauss-Jordan method and of course matrix methods. We will also discuss the eigenvalues of matrix in this lecture. So, to start the iterative method we will need some initial guess. And then we will need some procedure to find a better solution or the next approximate solution using the initial values. Of course, the iterative method need to be stopped and we will use some stopping criteria, that means the convergence condition, to terminate the iterative process. So, in this lecture we will discuss the simplest iterative method for solving system of linear equations, and this method is called Jacobi's method. For Jacobi's method we will need initial guess. So, if you have n simultaneous equations we will need n x values to start with, and then we will use the system of linear equations to redefine the different x values, rather x 1, x 2, x 3, x n, in terms of all other x values and the coefficients. So, we will use equations one by one and we will transfer the remaining part, we will keep the diagonal element on left hand side and we will transfer all other elements of the equation on right hand side. Then we will divide the whole equation by the diagonal coefficient, and that will give us the expression for the variable on left hand side, and the in the equation on right hand side we will have expression, that means the multiplication of coefficient and variables and summation of all these things divided by the diagonal element. We will explain this method through an example and then we will generalize it. So, on your screen see the equation 1 and 2, these two equations are forming the system of linear equations. And suppose the initial guess is 0 and 0, x 1 is equal to 0, x 2 is also 0. So, we use equation 1 to find the value of x 1, that means we transfer x 2 on right hand side and divide the right hand side by the coefficient of x 1, that is 3. So, you can see in equation 3 on your screen we will have the value of x 1 in terms of the coefficients and the variable x 2. Similarly, using equation 2 we will have the value of x 2 on left hand side, and on right hand side we will have the x 1 variable as well as coefficients. So, using equation 3 we can find out the next approximate solution of the system of linear equations. So, using the initial guess x 1 is equal to 0, x 2 is equal to 0 in equation 3, in next approximation we get the value of x 1 and x 2 as given by equation 4. So, now you can see that these newly calculated values can be used as initial values for next iteration, as we do in all iterative methods, and we use equation 3 to find next approximate value of the solution x 1 and x 2, and that is given by equation 5. Here you can see the equation gives you the values 0.9166 and 1.833. So, you are slowly converging to solution. We continue with the process, and you can see in next iteration we get the values x 1 and x 2 represented by equation 6, and then same process is repeated with these values which are given in equation 6 to find out next approximate value, which is given in equation 7, and there we find it is 0.99305 and 1.98611. The actual value if you do the Gauss elimination method is 1 and 2, and we are now very close to the actual value. So, if you continue with the iterative process, you will find in next iteration the values of x 1 and x 2 are 1.00463 and 2.00173. So, these values are accurate up to second place of decimal to the exact solution. So, we can continue with the iterative process and we will be very close to the exact solution x 1 is equal to 1 and x 2 is equal to 2 after few iterations. So, now we can generalize this process for the system of n equations. On your screen you can see how the n simultaneous equations will appear, will be represented. coefficients and then the variables, and sum of all these equal to a constant coefficient. So, this is the format of the simultaneous equations. So, we have n such equations. So, what we do? We keep the diagonal element on left hand side and transfer all other elements of the equation on right hand side. The diagonal elements are those elements which are having the coefficient with same index, the both index of the coefficient will be same as the index of the variable. That means, if for x 1 the diagonal element will be a 1 1, for x 2 the diagonal element will be a 2 2, and for general variable x I the diagonal element will be a I I. So, with this transformation we transfer the elements apart from the diagonal element all on right hand side, we get the next equation. You can see on your screen how this transformation will change the equations. Now, we divide these equations by the diagonal elements, and that will give us the equations in one variable. On left hand side we will have the variable x 1, x 2, x 3, and then on right hand side we will have the coefficients and all the remaining variables. So, in equation 10 we write the solution for equation x 1, in equation 11 we write the solution for x 2, in equation 12 we write the solution for x 3, and we can generalize it, and in equation 13 we write the solution for any general solution vector component, that is x I, and x I is given by this expression. You can note that the element on the right hand side corresponding to x I and a I I is missing because it is on right hand side. So, that is what we are doing. So, we are writing the solution in terms of the variables and the coefficients apart from the diagonal element. So, you can generalize it and you can write equation 15 for the diagonal elements, and you can write the solution for all the equations by using this generalized form, where x I is represented in terms of the coefficients and all remaining variables x j. You can see in equation 15 in summation we have just avoided the product of coefficient and variable with j is equal to I. That means, the diagonal elements are avoided because we are using it on left hand side. So, equation 15 can be used to generate the solution for any variable x I. So, now what we can do is we can just write the algorithm for producing the next approximate value by using the initial guesses. Suppose the initial guesses are x 0 I and I is changing from 1 to n. By using these initial values we can find out the next approximate value by using equation 15, and the element of algorithm will be very simple. We will be using a loop for I is equal to 1 to n do, and then we will approximate the new solution values by equation 15. That gives us x I is equal to 1 upon a I I, and inside bracket we are having the constant coefficient minus the summation of all the coefficient multiplied by the initial values apart from the diagonal elements. So, this gives us the next approximate solution. Now, to repeat the whole procedure, what we will do, we will just resubstitute the newly calculated value for the initial guess. So, this resubstitution can be done by using very simple algorithm element, and that is for I is equal to 1 to n do, and we are substituting the newly calculated value x I for the initial value x 0 I. So, once you do this thing you can repeat the whole procedure, and the repetition will continue till the solution converges. So, the convergence condition is to be decided, and what we do is we take the two successive values of x, that is means x means it is a vector, that means consisting of n elements. So, we take two successive values of the solution vectors and we compare the two solution vectors and find out the difference. If the difference reduces to allowed error, then we say that the two solutions are very close and we have got the approximate solution accurate up to the desired accuracy. Since in each solution vector there will be n elements, so what we will do, we will find out maximum error between the two consecutive two successive iterations in these elements. So, we will use a loop and we will start with initializing the maximum error to the error in first element in the solution vector, and then we will use a loop for I is equal to 2 to n, and there we will find the error and we will compare this error with the maximum error. If this error is greater than maximum error, then we will substitute this error as maximum error, and that will give us the maximum error in two iterations. So, we will just choose some allowed error, and that is suppose very some small positive number, say epsilon. Epsilon may be 0.0001 or so, and what we will do, we will just check if the maximum error is greater than this allowed error. If the maximum error is greater than this allowed error, we will continue with our iterative process, and that can be done by using a while loop. We will put a while loop while maximum error is greater than epsilon, then do the iterative procedure. So, we have now the elements of the algorithm. Separately, we have discussed these elements, and now we will combine all these elements to give the complete algorithm for this method. You can see on your screen the algorithm for this method. In step 1, we will read the number of variables of the equations, how many equations are there, and then we will use the allowed error, which is suppose epsilon EPS. Then we will read the initial guess. For any iterative method, we need initial guess. So, we will read the initial guess. The initial guess is suppose x 0 I for I is equal to 1 to n. Now, we initialize the maximum error to some positive value, say 1, because maximum error will be always less than 1. So, we initialize it to maximum value, say 1. Then we use the while loop and we check if the maximum error is greater than epsilon. Then inside the while loop, we start our solution procedure and we recalculate, or rather we find the next approximate value by using the equation 15. So, we start a loop for j is equal to 1 to n and sum all the coefficients, and we just put a condition that I should not be equal to j, because this is the diagonal value and which is on the left hand side. So, the loop j will give you sum in your equation 15. The sum is represented by loop for j is equal to 1 to n. Once you come out of this loop, you are having this sum, which is represented summation of all the values starting from j is equal to 1 to n. Using this sum in equation 15, you can find out the new approximate value of the solution vector, and that is the element x I is given by the constant a I n plus 1 minus sum divided by the diagonal element of the element x I, that is a I I. So, this is end of the outer loop. When you come out of this outer loop, you are having all the x new values for the next approximate solution. So, using this next approximate solution, we calculate the error, because we are having now two solutions, one previous solution and this new solution. So, we again use a loop as we have discussed earlier to find out the maximum error. You can see in step 4.2, we are calculating the maximum error in this iteration. So, we are having two successive iterations and we can find out maximum error. Now, if this maximum error is greater than epsilon, we will continue. So, what we do to continue, we use step 4.3 and we initialize the previous, or rather the initial guess, with the newly calculated values. So, we use the loop for I is equal to 1 to n, and we substitute x 0 I, that is the initial value, which is to be used in calculating the new approximate values, and that is initialized to x I, the values calculated in previous iteration. So, finally, when you come out of this while loop, that means when the maximum error becomes less than epsilon, we will print the values of the x I, and that will be our solution. So, this is how the solution procedure will be used in the Jacobi's method. Before we go to next method, it is very important to discuss pivoting. The pivoting is essential in all iterative methods, and we will explain this by an example. Consider the equation 16 and 17 on your screen, and if you use these equations as such, you will find the solution equations in equation 18 and 19. So, x 1 is represented as 12 minus 10 into x 2, and x 2 is represented as 1 upon 2 14 minus 6 x by using equation 16 and 17. Suppose the initial guess is 0 0, as we do. If we do not know initial guess, we use 0 0. So, using initial guess x 1 is equal to 0 and x 2 is equal to 0, we find the next approximate value of the solution for these two equations. We get x 1 is equal to 12 and x 2 is equal to 7. If we use this newly calculated value as initial guess, in next iteration we will find that x 1 is equal to minus 58 and x 2 is equal to minus 29. If we continue with this procedure for few more iterations, we will find that the result is diverging very fast. So, we will not be able to get the solution. The reason for this non-convergence is that we are using the equations without proper pivoting. As discussed earlier, the error in the approximation value of the solution will increase if the multiplicative coefficients are larger than the diagonal coefficients, because diagonal coefficients are in the denominator and all other coefficients are in the numerator multiplied by the value xi, variable xi. So, if there is error in the variable xi, it will get multiplied, because if multiplicative coefficients are larger, then it will increase. So, error will increase and we will not get a convergent solution. So, what shall we do? We shall do the pivoting. That means, we should arrange the equations such that the diagonal coefficients are largest in the given number of coefficients. So, this is what we will do in equation 20 and 21. We are rearranging the equations and we are taking equation second to represent the variable x 1 and using equation first to represent the variable x 2. So, if we use the sequence of equations 20 and 21, we get the solution equations 22 and 23, and here if you use the initial approximation x 1 is equal to 0 and x 2 is equal to 0, you will find that next approximation will give you the values 2.33 and 1.2. In few iterations, you will see that we are very close to the actual value, and that is 2 and 1. So, in some 5 iterations, we will be accurate up to third place of decimal, and if you continue with some more iterations, you will be very close to the exact solution, and that is 2 and 1. So, it is very important to use the equations in pivotal form before you start any iterative process. So, pivoting is essential, this is demonstrated by this example. Now, we come to next method, and that is Gauss-Seidel method. The Gauss-Seidel method is just extension of Jacobi's method. The only difference is we have the initial values, of course, we have to start with the initial values, and we will calculate the next approximate value by using the same set of solution equations. That means, we will keep the diagonal elements on left hand side and all other elements of the equation on right hand side, and we will express the variables in terms of all other variables and the coefficients. So, the expressions for the solution equation will be same as we do in the Jacobi's method. The only difference is that here we will not use the set of initial values to calculate all of the values in the solution vector. That means, we will not calculate x 1, x 2, x 3, x 4, x n with the same set of initial values x 0 I. Rather, what we will do, we will just calculate the first value. That means, x 1 will be calculated by using the initial values x 0 I starting from I is equal to 2 to n. Then, this newly calculated x value will be used in next solution equation. That means, for x 2, we will use the value of x 1 rather than x 0 1. In calculating x 3, we will use the newly calculated x 1 and x 2, and all other initial values of course, will be used, because we do not have the recent values of these variables. So, we will use the recent values to calculate the next variable in the set of equations. So, this is the major difference, and since we are getting the refined values in the same iteration, the method will converge faster than the Jacobi's method. So, a slight change in the algorithm will give you the Gauss-Seidel method, and you can see on your screen the algorithm. Step 1, 2 are same, step 3 is also same, and now what we do in step 4 is we calculate the recent value, and then we initialize this recent value to the previous guess, means it will be used as previous guess for the next value of xi. So, for every I, we are calculating x I and we will use it in the next value of I calculated by the loop 4.1, and this is the difference between the two methods. So, once you come out of the for loop in 4.1, you will have the complete solution. Then again, we are calculating the maximum error in this loop, and there is a while loop in step 4, which will be used to terminate the iterative process. The iterative process will be terminated, and we will print the values x I from I is equal to 1 to n. Here, we have assumed that the equations are properly pivoted, and the coefficients are already available in form of a matrix. That means, the coefficients are read by using loop. Here we give the element of the algorithm for reading the coefficients. We are using two loops for I is equal to 1 to n and j is equal to 1 to n, and we are reading the coefficients a i j. This is assumed that the coefficients are available. So, this gives you the solution through Gauss-Seidel method. The Gauss-Seidel method is slightly better than the Jacobi's method, because here we are using the refined solution in the iteration itself. Now, we will discuss the eigenvalues of matrices. We have discussed the solution of simultaneous equations. Now, if the constant coefficient on right hand side of the simultaneous equations is identically 0, then the set of equations is called the homogeneous equations. The set of n homogeneous equations can be represented by a matrix equation as given on your screen, A x is equal to 0. Now, the A matrix is the matrix of coefficients, and the homogeneous equations are given by equation 24 as you can see on your screen. And now, the matrix A, which is matrix of coefficients represented by the coefficient a11 up to ann. And what we can do is, we can find out a solution for this equation A x is equal to 0. If the determinant of A is not equal to 0, then identically the x vector should be equal to 0. So, what we can do for finding a solution? We should make the determinant of A equal to 0. For that, suppose we find a matrix A minus lambda I, where lambda is some scalar and I is the identity matrix. And if the determinant of this matrix A minus lambda I becomes 0, then we can find out a solution of this matrix equation A lambda I x is equal to 0. So, x will be a non-zero solution if we can find a matrix A minus lambda I with determinant 0. So, this type of equation with the determinant of A minus lambda I is equal to 0 having some non-zero solution in form of vector x I is called the eigenvalue problem. And here the value lambda, the scalar lambda, is called the eigenvalue, and the vector x, which is solution of this equation, is called the eigenvector. So, we will try to find out the solution of this. There are different methods, direct method as well as iterative methods, but here we will discuss the power method, which is an iterative method. So, as in all iterative method, we will need some initial guess for the solution, and suppose the initial guess for the eigenvector is x 0. So, we use this initial eigenvector x 0 to generate the next eigenvector x 1, and that is given by equation 27. We operate the eigenvector x 0 on matrix A, and we will find the next eigenvector x 1. Since in equation 26, we can see that the x 1, that should be equal to lambda into x. So, what we do, we just find out the maximum element of x 1 and take it out of the eigenvector, and we will find the eigenvector in form of equation 28, where we are having the constant lambda 1 out and the x 0 1 is the new eigenvector. Using this x 0 1 new eigenvector, we use again and we find out again the value of the new eigenvector x 2 by operating the x 0 1 on matrix A. So, that gives us equation 29. Again, what we do? We use the same method and we represent x 2 in terms of a constant lambda 2 multiplied by x 0 2. This lambda 2 is the maximum element of the eigenvector x 2. Similarly, we continue, and after k iterations, we will find that the newly calculated eigenvector x k, which is equal to A multiplied by x 0 k minus 1, can be represented by lambda k multiplied by x 0 k. So, this is how we will continue, and we will find out that when the two successive values of x 0, that means the eigenvectors x 0 k and x 0 k minus 1, are close enough, that means the difference between the element by element difference between the two is very small within allowed error, we will stop the iterative process. The power method can be explained by using an example, and here we give an example, and then the algorithm can be developed by using this example. So, we give in equation 33 the matrix for which we want to find out the eigenvalue and eigenvector. So, let the initial eigenvector is 1 1 1. So, using this initial eigenvector 1 1 1, we find out the next solution vector, and that is the 6 8 4. You can see on your screen, if you multiply 1 1 1 by the matrix, you will get 6 8 4. So, we take the maximum of these elements out of the column matrix, and that is 8 is taken out, and then the resulting column matrix 0.75 1 and 5 is the next eigenvector. So, using this, we get in next iteration 5, 5.75 and 3.25 as the next eigenvector, and from this we take the maximum element out of this matrix, and that is 5.75 is taken outside, and we get the next eigenvector. We continue and we find in the next iteration the element which is taken out is 6.302, and in next iteration it is 6.155, in next iteration it is 6.197, and then it is 6.185, and the eigenvector is having values 0.8471 and 0.549. And in next iteration we find that the element which is taken out is 6.188, and the eigenvector is exactly same as in the previous iteration. So, this gives us the convergent solution for the matrix eigenvalue, and the eigenvalue is the constant which is multiplied by the eigenvector. So, the eigenvalue is 6.188 and the eigenvector is 0.8471, 0.549. So, this is how the eigenvalues and eigenvectors can be calculated by using the power method. In today's lecture, we discussed the iterative methods for solving the system of linear equations. We discussed the Jacobi's method, and we also discussed the Gauss-Seidel method. Then we discussed the eigenvalue problem for matrices, and we discussed the power method, which is also iterative method to find out eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Hope you enjoyed the lecture. Thank you.